empty pans.
Are these all from things that you used to have?
No, I bought them empty.
Oh.
We'll talk about why in a minute.
Okay.
So I did a lot of research on, probably know more about watercolor now than I needed to know, and I didn't read all the history on here because it was long and boring.
Okay.
But if you go to Wikipedia, and I'm guessing they have the same color, if you typed in acrylic painting.
Probably the same thing.
There's so much information, and I know we already talked about the main difference between watercolor and gouache is that watercolor is transparent and gouache is opaque.
Mm-hmm.
That's the main difference.
I've had heard some people say about these that they're
We're gonna test that. I got my black pen.
Okay. Well, oh, if they're
opaque or not? Because
they are a little more opaque than traditional watercolors.
They seem to be when I did my swatch card. They seem to be more opaque than my other colors.
I will say, this color, it's not as opaque. I had to kind of do it a couple times to make it a little deeper color because I wanted to have the deep color on there so I knew what it looked like. And I think the same thing with a little bit of the pale aqua. A couple of them. You're still going to
Well, and I've always sort of mixed, maybe because when I started watercoloring, I didn't really know what I was doing. I was just playing.
Mm-hmm.
But I've always kind of mixed my watercolor and gouache anyway on the same piece because just depending on what kind of effect I was trying to get. So I don't necessarily keep them that separate. I do have separate palettes for, I do have one that's just gouache, but that doesn't mean I don't paint with that when I'm painting with watercolor. I do sometimes, just to get different effects, and especially if I've put some watercolor paint somewhere and then I don't like the way that looks and I want to make it less busy, then I'll go over it with some gouache and sort of, white out some of what's on there.
Kind of like a little bit of whitewash gesso.
Yep.
Over a mixed media piece.
Okay. And the main difference between, say, hobbyist grade watercolor paint, there's a different word for it, and it's in here somewhere.
What do you mean by hobbyist?
I know. Hang on. There's in here somewhere, I don't know. Oh boy.
Page flags.
I know. It came with all that stuff. It was just like that.
Ruler. Awesome.
Okay, so you have three different grades of watercolor. You have artist grade, which I have some out here we can play with, student grade, and then scholastic grade. Scholastic grade, it reminds me kind of like of kids grade, like Crayola.
Like Crayola,
water. Yeah. These, Kuretake and the Koi, seem to be, from what I've read, like scholastic grade paint or crafter grade paint. They're not artist quality. They don't have, from what I've seen, I can't find any documentation on light fastness or, any of those like archival kind of things you would want to know about the paint if you're a professional artist and you're doing a painting with the paint.
Uh-huh. I did watch a review video on these where somebody said she contacted the company. I don't know exactly through what.
Right, and they may have it out
and
there.
That,
I just,
they didn't
not
have any number. They didn't have a score.
Yeah.
But they did say it's very light fast.
Yeah.
I don't know what they mean by that.
But we can't find that anywhere. And the same with the Koi. Like, I love the Koi. They're just as well, in my opinion, pigmented as the Kuretake. Mm-hmm. But there's no, like, info out there anywhere.
So I don't know what. I don't know how to pronounce it, but I want to say Sumi painting?
Sumi, yeah.
What is that?
That's an Asian style of watercolor painting.
Okay, because that's what these, I think, are meant for.
Yeah.
Traditionally.
I think so, too. That's why they're more opaque, because that kind of painting is not necessarily done, I don't think, with lots of translucent paint.
Okay. Because, I think that's why
these are equally as good, and in my opinion, just as bright, mm-hmm. but they're more traditional transparent watercolors than those
mm-hmm.
are.
Can I see those?
That's the one that's in my red go bag all the time.
Oh, okay. Those are beautiful colors.
Now,
trust me, you could still get them to be very translucent if you want, but if you're going straight from the pan to the paper, it's going to be a lot harder.
You have to add more water. So one thing I will tell you and the viewers is if you want to know a lot about watercolor paint and transparency, the history of watercolor, like, just go to Wikipedia. I'll try to put the link in the description below, but it tells you all about the pigments and staining characteristics and granulation and another word I can't pronounce. There is just so much information. And we also found a little, I found a little bit on the koi watercolors. There's not a lot out there, but I found a little bit. And I'll link, put that link. And Sarah found some interesting information about the Kuretake set too. So we'll try to, I printed it all, but we'll try to link everything. And we're going to play with, I can't play with my paint with my reading glasses on. We're going to play with some different paints, so.
Okay.
We'll talk about these half pans in a minute. These are all over here.
There's some full pans in there, too.
Yeah. These are all artist grade paints. Really, in the student grade paint, I only have the koi set anymore. Okay. I've gotten rid of everything else because I don't like them, to be frank. I love my koi set, and I love my Kuretake set. They have different properties. The Kuretake set's not as portable, so it probably, like, I would take it probably with the koi set, like when we go to Lake Tahoe, or we go on a road trip and we're driving, but where I'm going next week, I'm flying, I would just take the koi because it's smaller, and it'll fit better in my carry-on. I have the smaller set. Sarah has the ginormous one. And I repanned mine in a quart box.
Although my broken pan.
And so see, another water brush. So when I repanned mine, I got enough room in there to stick a water brush in there.
Yeah, I love that idea.
So I can just, if I wanted to, I could just take this and a block of paper and I'd be good.
I'm wondering if there's something I can think of to put in here to kind of hold the pans from jostling around.
What about bubble wrap? A layer of thin bubble wrap.
I'd have to get some.
I bet you could talk the Postal Annex people into giving you a sheet.
Maybe.
I don't have any, or I'd give you a piece.
Ah, whatever. I'll figure it out. I'm sure I have something.
A piece torn off a padded envelope.
I'm sure I have some of those laying around.
So, the first thing I thought we would do is play with the comparing the koi set with the Kuretake set.
Oh, so I should have mine.
And what I like to do when I do this is compare colors, and you also can just kind of play. Like, this was done, I was just playing with colors of a paint set, and it's just an abstract thing with puddles of watercolor paint.
Well, did you do that when we were,
I think last, last one time? Of the time we were
not here, last time, but time, like, before that. Time before that when Claudia was here, right?
And this, yeah, and this is the one I did yesterday. I just was playing with puddles of watercolor paint, and honestly, that's how all of these started out. Yes, I was working on some assignments.
Is this hot press too? This feels very, very smooth.
This is hot press, yeah.
I was going to say.
Yeah. And these are all cold press. You can feel the texture.
I like the texture, but I haven't tried hot press for a
I tried it, and I got to be honest, hot press is not my favorite. It's too smooth. I'm used to watercoloring on something with texture.
But that's the only difference. Like, it'll handle the watercolor the same way that cold press will. Yeah. Just texture. Okay.
There is a kind of paper by Fabriano called soft press.
Really?
And it's halfway between cold press and hot press. And it's,
so if you don't like quite the Amano texture on a cold press.
Soft press.
That's interesting.
Soft press,
I really
like
this. See, me, I would literally try to draw the lines, and I know you can't really do that.
No, and watercolor. I drew any lines that were on any of these after the watercolor was dry. Mm-hmm.
I mean, like, with the watercolor.
Oh, yeah.
It would take, obviously. How long did it take for you to get to?
I did all of these in, like, an hour.
No, I'm saying to get to this point where you could do these that fast.
I started watercoloring in 2007.
I guess I'll be 40 by the time I get to this point. If I can even learn as fast as you did.
So I'm not going to use that one because that one's wet.
I really love your expressive style.
Oh, thank you. I want my painting to be a relaxing thing, and that's, you know,
I think my style, once I actually settle in on a style, I think I'll end up doing, being a little more precise.
If Sarah shows up her color card and you compare it to mine, her colors are way more perfect than mine because I'm just not there. And I wanted to see the darkest shade all the way to the lightest shade, and she didn't do that so much. Neither one is wrong.
I did do a little bit of a light shade, but not quite as...
Right, neither one is wrong, mind you. There, you could do it either way, but every time I get a watercolor kit, I make one of these. every time, because you cannot tell by looking at the pan what the color is going to be.
Yeah, big difference on especially you can tell really because of the big pans here. You wouldn't know that these two are purple.
No, because they look black. Okay, so I'm going to write, koi. And then I'm going to pick a color that's similar to one in my box. Let's see. How about we'll do the koi cadmium red, which is this one, compared to the kuretake red. They're pretty close in color.
The koi is a little deeper, a little more of a true red than the kuretake, but yeah. Well, based on those swatches.
And I'm going to label it. And then what you can do is just put, and this is a carbon ink pen. It's permanent when it's dry. And it's waterproof. So yes. Then what I want to do is I want to just do a squiggle.
Oh, so you can test the...
Yeah, so you can do two swatches. You can do one over the ink to see how opaque it is, and one on the plain paper to just see just the color.
Mm-hmm.
And when you're comparing paints, and then, like, I'm going to do one card, and I'm just going to do all a bunch of reds, and we're going to start with the two student grade paints, and we'll do, I've got a Schmink palette here. I've got, this is my mixed palette. This has Quar, Winsor & Newton, Grumbacher, Van Gogh, and a couple of Schminks in it. And I've got the Mayberry palette, which is this one. And I've got Daniel Smith, and we've got one of these.
You're an awesome influence. I'm gonna want
to. I know. Peerless, and I love this tin. I know, aren't they great? I love this tin. That's the Schmink one. Oh, and the Van Gogh. So cool. All right, water brush.
Oh, yeah. And do you mind if I use your pen?
Nope.
So we're doing. Oops. Koi?
Yes.
Can you spell it?
I'm going to... K-O-I. Now, when I buy paint palettes, one thing I always try to look for is how easily is it refillable? One of the problems I had with the first paint palette, watercolor palette I bought, was because it was a very inexpensive one, and I right away used up all the yellow ochre and then found out the company didn't make refills. So... Yeah, so you can get refill pans for the Kuretake from Jackson Art Supply, which we found out. Yay, Jackson's Art Supply. Yes, they're out of the UK, but shipping's not that bad. And they get the stuff gets here really quickly, because I've ordered from them before. The Koi set, you can get some refills, which I like. Mm-hmm. But you can't get all of them. Like, they sell tubes of paint, but their tube set only has 18 colors in it. This is the 24-color set.
It's interesting.
So there's some colors missing. So...
Kuretake is spelled with an E at the end.
Oh, oops. I spelled it wrong. Big surprise!
Me too. Because I looked at yours and I was like, oh yeah, that's
right.
Yeah.
No, it's not.
I blame you for it.
So I like and prefer sets that have easily obtainable refills. Because when you have a set like any of these,
mm-hmm.
you're not going to use up all the colors right away. You'll find after you've painting for a while, there'll be one color that is probably going to be an unexpected color. For me, that was yellow ochre. That is the one that goes out first.
Mm-hmm.
And then you're like, okay, well, crap, I still have lots of good paint in there, you know, but I don't have any yellow ochre. Now what am I going to do?
Mm-hmm. And so, I did check that the Kuretake, Jackson's Art does sell every single color, single paint.
See,
they might not be in stock right now, but...
No, but they sell them, and most of the student paints don't have any refills available. So the fact that Koi has any, even if not all of them, is good, and the fact that
mm-hmm.
Kuretake has all of them is fabulous. One of the reasons a lot of people right away go to Artist Paint is because most of your Artist Paint companies, if not all of them, yes, they make cake watercolor sets like Van Gogh, but they sell the same exact color in tube form. So if you run out of a color, you just go buy the tube and refill your little pan.
Okay.
So, which one is my red? Oh, this one. Okay. Put the right swatch in the right place. Now with these brushes, you can squeeze it if you need some more water.
Okay. Yeah, I'll probably use these brushes more for the washes.
I forgot paper towels.
Oh, I'm gonna try to bring some with me on the plane.
Yeah, or ask these stewardess for extra napkins.
That's true. But I'll probably still pack some in my bag anyways, just in case. Well, I already like the smoothness of this. One thing I noticed is that you don't see hot presses as much in stores.
No, you don't.
It's a lot harder to find.
It is. So that's kind of decently opaque. It's not super, I mean, I can still see the black line, but.
Yeah, and this is on hot press, so.
Yeah. And it's smooth, and the difference between the hot press and the cold press is you can see where the paint settles in the nooks and crannies on the cold press.
Mm-hmm. And this pools smooth. At the bottom and probably yeah. would do drips
yeah.
better.
Yeah, yeah.
So it just depends on what you're trying to
this
do.
This is the koi. Okay, there
Which
you
one
know,
is it?
This is the it's this one right here. The cadmium red. It's a little bit more of an orangey red, where just, the Kurataki is more of a blue red.
Yeah, I see.
But
yeah.
See, they're both, in my opinion, those are both equally pigmented. Neither one is, I don't think, any more opaque or transparent than the other one.
Yeah, they're both.
They're both nice.
But yeah, they are very nice.
All right, and then we have.
Okay,
see, we forgot the art guard again. Sarah and I are so bad.
I have a thing at home, and I think I haven't used it since we went.
So now we have these other kits that you can try, and you can pick out a red that's close and see, compared to these artist paints, what the student grade paints look like.
Okay.
I don't have as many colors in the May Mary because I just started my collection in, so... I just don't have any.
Just started,
yeah.
She made room by giving away her other stuff.
I did. And these are Schmink. These are the Schmink paints, which you'll probably really like. Everybody likes Schmink.
Let's see what colors they got. I would say... I think the scarlet red would probably be the closest on here.
Yeah. Now, when you're just starting out and you're playing, you don't have to invest in these expensive artist paints. One of these, like Kurataki or the Koi set, is good enough until you decide how much you love watercoloring. Mm-hmm. I have a friend like me who loves watercolor and has them, and you want, you know, then you have the opportunity to come over and say, Gina, can I try some of your paint? It's all right with me.
Gina, thank you for letting me win the,
yeah.
the giveaway. Not like you had a choice.
Oops. I've chosen it random.
I know.
Okay, let's
you
see.
You recorded it.
I did. Right,
so, what? Is, I don't even know how to spell these.
It's a German word. And I've heard it pronounced a lot of different ways. While she's doing that, I'll say that some companies, not all of them, will sell you or give you color sample cards.
Mm-hmm.
Golden's Quar Paint has these kind of color cards, and I've turned them into this little like sample paint book that I can take with me when I'm traveling. Daniel Smith has big 8.5 by 11 sheets. I cut them down to fit in here, and they actually, both of these actually have dots of little dots of dried up paint on them. The Daniel Smith one is nice. I don't know. Let's see. Okay, so... No, the Quar one doesn't have it on there that I see. I like the Daniel Smith one because for each and every color, it gives you a rating for how light fast it is, whether the pigment that was used to make the color is toxic or not. And it tells you how light fast it is, what the rating is. Is it staining or not? Does it granulate or not? How transparent is it? And I love that about their paint. So they have all these little codes at the bottom of their paint.
All right, guys. So Daniel Smith, what else are we doing? How do you
Daniel
think?
Smith, Schmink, Mary, and Van Gogh. I spelled it wrong. M-E-R-I.
And
I spelled it wrong. Big surprise. Van Gogh.
It's G-O-G-H. Right?
Yep. And if you want to, you can do the peerless, if you want to. Peerless. That's the little ones that are on paper. I need to borrow the pen so I can fix my spelling here. Okay, so for Daniel Smith, you have the Daniel Smith palette, or do I?
I have the Schmink.
I have the Daniel Smith palette.
Tidying.
So, yeah. On the Daniel Smith, we have Equidoquidone Red, which should be close. And then on the Van Gogh, we have Permanent Red Deep.
I'm thinking for the Schminky, or I don't know how to pronounce it, Scarlet Red would probably be the closest.
Yeah. And I always pronounce it weird, too, so. It's German, I don't know. I have trouble with English.
Me too.
What was it? Scarlet Red?
Scarlet Red, yeah.
And the May Mary, I don't have enough colors, so we probably just have to go with the primary red magenta.
Yeah.
It's not really the same.
Beautiful colors, though. I wonder. Look at the one that you.
That's a mix of colors. I don't
remember.
Oh,
I know. Let's see. Oh, you put ruby red.
Oh, that's a Schmink color.
Mm-hmm. And then Van Gogh.
The ruby.
Batter Lake Deep.
Yeah.
But those aren't really quite that close, so.
No, and the ruby red is a good color. Let's see. I'm lost. Let's see. Get some paint wet.
What's the Daniel Smith one?
Quinacridone red. I just put Quinn red. I don't spell out quinacridone unless you have make me. It's
me,
a really hard word to
me
spell.
Me neither. And what would we just say? Primary red magenta.
I don't think we decided on this one because this box has a mix of different paints in it. So let's just close that one up for now.
And then what do we decide for Van Gogh? Permanent red deep? Really like this pen.
It's a great pen. I got it at Amazon.
And you get refills too?
Yep.
Nice. Oh, I shouldn't have asked because now I'm going to want to keep it.
Okay, see, that's just the first color going on, and this is the Van Gogh.
Do you not care about everything else getting wet?
No, it doesn't. No, it doesn't matter. And look at that. That's a. Comparatively, I'd say those student grade paints, they look pretty nice. This is a little bit brighter.
Mm-hmm.
These are duller. But I think when you're starting out, you know, these are a pretty good option. That is nice. I like that. All right, let's see. Daniel Smith is made in Seattle. I believe.
Gina, I just started to drool.
I see the Schmink paints. The Schmink paints it's are so nice.
Smooth and beautiful.
Yep. There's a Daniel Smith.
Nice.
Yep.
Very nice. But yeah, even the student grades to Schmink.
Right? Pretty nice. So here, I'll trade you.
And this is the, which one?
Quinacridone Red.
Oh, Daniel Smith, okay.
It's written on the back of the color key.
I know, I should.
Otherwise,
I should have just looked.
I get them confused. At some point, though, I'm going to have to, like, label my box because I have too many of the same box.
Mm.
That's going to confuse me at some point. Now, the artist grade paints, like I said, you can refill them from their tubes are the same color. So if you run out of one,
I wonder, the core?
Yeah.
Do they have the same colors in the, as their, do their watercolor names and pigments match their acrylics?
Some, yeah, and that's a good idea. So I don't think I have the Quar in, I don't know if I have a red. I have Alizarin Crimson, and I have a Quidoquidone Red.
Okay.
We'll have to, make room. I ran out of room on my sheet.
I still see you. This seems a little more opaque, or maybe I just picked up a little more paint than they have.
Which, Daniel Smith?
Yeah.
Yeah.
A little more.
And it's also, you can see it's more of a pink red or a blue red than the others are more of an orange red.
I think.
But it is one of my favorite colors of Daniel Smith paint.
Since this is kind of a test for hot press paper for me too,
yeah.
I will say, depending if I want to be free and just kind of let the paint do its own thing, I don't think I'd have a problem with this. But if I'm trying to be my normal self and control everything, I'm not going to like it, because I think that you have less control with the hot press than with the cold press.
Yep. So I'm going to, let's see, it's this one right here.
And
this is the Quar.
Were we doing?
See, it's very much, it's very much like like the Daniel Smith. See, that's the Quar.
Oh, okay.
It's the same color paint as Quidoquidone Red. But yes, they have a cobalt teal in the Quar, just like the acrylic paint. So I'm missing one. Oh, May Mary. This one. And if you're a student of Journaling Crazy Island Style, and you did a reference book, this is a good test to put in the watercolor section of your reference book.
I'm a student and I didn't do it yet.
Oops. Now the May Mary seems to be pretty well pigmented, but it's more translucent than the other ones.
Oh, it is. It's beautiful color.
It's a beautiful color, but look how much more translucent it is than almost all the other ones that are on there.
Hmm.
That's interesting.
Is it just QOR?
Yeah.
Well, how do they compare, how do the different ones, compare, in price? I'm not asking for your actual numbers, but,
Your most expensive one that we have on the table here is the Schmink.
Okay.
Your artist paints are sets. We'll just talk about sets instead of tubes, but the Van Gogh's the most affordable set. This one was under $80. I actually got it a lot cheaper than that because it was old packaging. There was nothing wrong with it. The paints were fine, but the packaging was old, so I got a big discount.
Okay.
So that's a great way to buy, by FYI. If you see the package on the shelf at the art store that has the old packaging and it's at the bottom, pull that one out because you might get a discount. The Schmink are not only really nice artist grade paint with really great light fastness and rich color and all that stuff. They're also imported from Germany, and so whereas this one costs about $80, but this doesn't have as many colors. This has 18 or something. The Schmink has 48 colors. That's I got it for less than this, but the retail on it I think is $600.
Oh, geez.
So.
But how about, say, Koi? Because I know a lot of people
The Koi? The Koi is, I love the Koi.
Oh, sorry, the Quar.
The Quar, they have a few sets, but the sets only have, a few tubes in them. They don't have, a 48-color set.
Oh, they only do with bed tubes, usually?
Yeah. They do have a few sets that have, 8 tubes, or I think, 12 tubes in them, and they're about $30, $40. So that's not bad.
Especially for golden.
Exactly. And I like the tubes because you can get a palette like this metal box empty, which is how I got this one with the May Mary paints in it. And you can get them from a number of different places. I got this one from Jackson's, and it's less than half the price of the Schmink box, which I got from Dick Blick, FYI. And even with shipping from the UK, it was still half the price. And I got it, I ordered it from Jackson through Amazon.
Oh, so this is a, oh, just a watercolor palette.
Just the box. I got the box empty. And it didn't have the pans in it or anything. And if you look, here is the box I got from Jackson's through Amazon. It was half the price of this one that's from Dick Blick. That's
it's
a schmink box.
It says schmink on it.
Yes.
That's why.
And this is more expensive. Neither one of them come with the little pans in them to put the paint in. They both come completely empty. So when you get a box like this, you have to buy these little pans. And they come like this. And so you get these little pans and then you pop them in here. Let's see if I can pop one out. So then you pop them in here and you can get... go that way, it goes this way. You can get 48 of these littler half pans in one of these boxes versus 24 full pans, which are these bigger ones. But you have to remember to order pans when you order the box because you won't have anything to put the paint in. Now, by association, the Kuretake set has full, the really big full pans, and they are plastic. So when you run out of your paints, if you empty a pan, you know, I wouldn't throw the pan away. I'd save it, and then if you wanted, you could refill it with something else.
Yeah, because if you're going to buy a new separate pan, single pan, it's already going to be in the pan. You don't have to worry about...
Yeah.
Since it's a hard watercolor.
Yeah.
Okay. Where's the May Mary again?
This one's May Mary. It's that one.
Talking too much.
But see, then if you're doing the reference book, you have a nice chart like this, and you can do all the brands of paint that you have. And you have a nice comparison. This is a good selection of paints. And you really only need to worry about light fastness and all that if you're going to do a piece that's for sale and or a piece that's going to maybe hang on the wall, especially if it's going to be exposed to any sunlight.
Yeah,
then
if you're
just
doing it in a journal, it's not a big deal.
If you're just doing it in a journal, nope, it's not a big deal. Or on mail art or something like that. It's not a big deal.
Yeah, I'm not to the point where I really need to worry about them. Because everything I do is in journals anyways. And then so where is the core?
The core is in this one. And this is a mixed box. And this is the one when I take one of these bigger palettes with me traveling, I take this one. Because it has kind of a selection of almost all the brands that you see here on the table.
Mm-hmm.
The core is this one here. And it also has space for one more kind of paint because, you know, I really need one more tube of paint. I think we should do like a turquoisey blue next because I just like turquoise. Oh, maybe we should do Prussian
That's
blue.
Beautiful.
Isn't that pretty?
I think it's because I'm used to using golden and fluid acrylics.
Yep.
So when I see the colors down on the paper, I recognize them.
It's,
I may not recognize the names, but I recognize the colors.
Right, and they're the thing I like about the Quar is all of those colors we've fallen in love with in the golden paint range,
mm-hmm.
they made them in watercolor.
That's why I'm like...
yep. And I didn't buy a lot of Quar, but I bought those colors.
For those of you that are jealous right now of me, don't be, because this is making me want to buy all of them.
She doesn't get to take them home. They have to stay here.
Okay.
Okay, I don't know what color you want to do, Lex, but I'm going to do a blue.
A blue?
I'm going to do blues.
Blues sound good.
I'm going to do... I don't know. See, we could do Prussian blue. I don't have that in all of them, but I have something that's close in all of them.
What does the Prussian blue look like on the
It's a turquoisey blue.
Okay, so...
Do we have it in the Kuretake? Let's see.
I might have it in mine. Here, because mine has a little more. I'm trying to figure out which one. There's a couple that could be close.
So,
kind of.
I would go with this one, number 66. They call it a violet. It doesn't look violet to me. But it looks more like Prussian blue.
Oh, the menthol violet.
Menthol violet, which... and. You guys should see this. It's this one right here. That is not violet. I don't know. But
this is also there some of the names are a little odd.
Well, you know, I know from my wholesale buying days when I was in the gift shop that when we would order gift bags, tissue paper, fabric, or whatever from Asia, the color names were always one thing, and we would expect a certain color, and something completely different would come in. So we usually tried to ask for swatches because it was different.
It's probably the translation, too.
I think so, yeah.
I'm just going to do mine next to it since I have more space on the
paper. I need to do another card. Let's see. So it's menthol. No, wait. And the koi. It's Prussian blue.
Yeah. I'll just copy your list afterwards. You don't have this one on your in your set?
No.
Okay. Actually have more colors of watercolor than her in one set anyway. But that's only because this is my only full set. I wanted to have all the colors. Because there's only 36, it's not like I was going to have to buy a ton of them.
Tip of the iceberg.
And I got it 50% off, so I got it for $20. Got it for less than the smaller set.
In the Daniel Smith, which is I think that one.
This one?
I think so. Let's see.
Yeah, it's Daniel Smith.
So we don't really have a
Prussian
blue, but we have phthalo turquoise. It's a little bit different color, but it'll work. We have lunar blue. Let's do lunar blue. So Daniel Smith has some different colors than anybody else, not just because of the name, but because of the pigments that they use. They're completely different than other people, like moon glow. I love that color. Let's do lunar blue.
Okay.
And then schmink. I didn't think to tell you to bring a pen.
I had it on my mind, but I was actually being good today and not bringing my whole stash of art supplies, so.
And then do we have in the core anything that's close? Let's see. Well, I have phthalo blue. Which I'm constantly spelling wrong.
P-H-T-H-A-L-O, I believe.
I think so. That's how I wrote it on here. That doesn't mean it's correct, but that's how I wrote it on here.
Only reason why I remembered that is because I'm always spelling it wrong as well, so. Were you going to do the same?
And then Mary. Let's see. In the May Mary, I have Prussian blue. It's one of my favorite colors, so it's usually one that I buy. Okay, here. Oh, wait. Okay.
All right, so what are we doing for koi? Prussian blue. I like that using this pen forces you to not press hard. I tend to be a heavy writer.
Yeah.
So, and you don't want to break it, obviously.
No,
nope, so
because of the kind of the tip that's on there. You don't want to press too hard.
Exactly. So I like that.
Gives you a nice delicate line.
It's good practice for when I use my Pitt Artist pens because their tips are so delicate they can break easily too or get squished easily.
Yep.
They're too expensive to.
What's really fun to do when you get to a certain point is to get one of these empty palettes, like I did with this one, and put your favorite colors from each one of the lines into that palette, and then you have your own like custom palette.
Oh, like
so you have your favorite yellows from maybe a couple different brands and your favorite purples, because you'll find that you gravitate towards, like even on this red one, all of them are beautiful, mm-hmm. but I think that my favorite one of all of them that I would probably use the most is probably either the koi or the schmink.
I was going to say for red specifically.
Yeah.
Because some of them are more pinkish.
Right.
Like you said.
And I was avoiding that. Like if you were talking about pink, it would probably be the Daniel Smith. I like that red.
Yeah, that's very pretty.
Yeah.
But The schmink is really nice, but I don't obviously know very much, but just by looking at the swatches.
And that's all right now as a beginner. That's all you need to be worried about. You know, if you want to learn more and you want to learn about light fastness and all that, like I said, that's great. But when you're starting out, you just need to find colors that you think are pretty. You don't need to know more than that. And you don't need to freak yourself out thinking you need to know more than that. The Kuretake. That's really pretty.
Oh, where's the cover for that?
Oh, here.
Put it down without it.
That's really pretty. Okay, that is not violet. They call that menthol violet.
But it's menthol, and menthol is like a blue.
Yeah, but menthol violet. That doesn't make sense, but it's menthol violet. Okay, let's see, Koi. This one.
But as you see how much pigment you pick up just by barely putting the, but see how this is kind of, I got a ton of pigment, probably because it's been sitting in the,
because
so it's a little more opaque.
So if you pick, when you pick it up, if you pick it up with more paint than water, and it's a little drier, you get a darker pigment like you just did, which is when I picked it up, it was
here,
right after it had been sprayed.
So and see.
And see, you can tell the difference. But look at the Koi and the Kuretake. They're pretty, I like both of those. They're pretty well pigmented, both of them. They're all just, again, just about equal. And this is the Van Gogh. Let's see. Van Gogh.
Yeah, that's the right one. Okay, so where, all right, so this is the Van Gogh. I'm assuming it's this one right here?
Yep. The one with the big hole in it, because I used it a lot. All right, but this one is...
Oh, look, see? Color that had pooled
see?
In that one?
See?
It dripped.
Because there's
kinda
no, like
that.
There's no texture for it to, like, get caught in.
Ooh, that's beautiful.
So this is the Quarthalo blue. You know, it's a good color. It's,
I won't be using this paper on the plane.
Slightly different than the... Prussian blue, but that's the core color. It's not that different. It's just a bit brighter.
Yeah, a little more, yeah. Can't think
this
of the word that
schminked.
I wanted to say.
It happens to me all the time.
And this is what again?
That's Prussian green. I'm picking up the wrong color.
This is the
Koi? That's the Koi, yeah.
And
I was wondering why that was like green, because I picked up the wrong color.
Oops.
Oops.
And it's this one right here?
Yep. Well, that makes more sense now. It's blue. That's the schmink.
Oh, that's beautiful.
Yeah.
People are going to wish that they could see down, like, the way you normally film.
Probably.
You might have to do, like, a view, of a better view of them so they can review.
So this is not quite the same color. This is Lunar Blue, which is more gray and less turquoise.
And were we doing? Yeah, we did name it. And that is Prussian.
And I'm sure Daniel Smith makes a, I'll look. I have their sample sheet. I'm sure they make a Prussian blue.
Who?
Daniel Smith. But that's their Lunar Blue, which is more gray.
Oh, wow, yeah.
It's like a light Payne's gray.
I was just going to say Payne's gray.
Yeah, it's a nice color, though. I like it. Let's see.
This is really nice paint.
The Mayberry?
Yeah.
I like the Mayberry paint. It's made in Italy.
And this one
blue.
Is Schmink? Oh, Daniel Smith.
Oh, they do. Prussian blue. This is from the color dot chart.
I'll have to grab some and do a little swatch.
Yeah, I'm going to just do a little.
Where was the...
Oh, that is a pretty color.
Where was the lunar blue?
It's like five from the right.
Yeah, I found it. It was wet.
Okay, that is the Daniel Smith, the little tiny line of the Daniel Smith Prussian blue. I'll make a note. But that's a pretty color. That's a color I don't own.
You see yours? Oh, that is really
pretty. Isn't that pretty? Yeah. It's in the bottom, in the middle, on there.
Oh, okay. But this lunar blue is really nice.
I like the lunar blue, and I like the moon glow, and they have a couple other colors like that that are way different than anything anybody else carries, and they're my favorite. One of the reasons that Daniel Smith is one of my favorites.
I was just going to ask you, what's your favorite brand of watercolor?
Daniel Smith. All the way. I like the other brands, and there's nothing wrong with them, and if any of you other companies are watching and you want to send me paint to try, I'm all up for that, because I love watercolor.
But yeah, you wouldn't have them if you didn't like them, right?
Exactly, and I own a lot of different brands. I love them all.
Plus, like we're seeing here, there's different brands that can have the same color, but different pigments.
Yeah, yeah. And when you're painting certain pictures and you want a certain shade of a certain color, and I hate mixing color.
Or schmink?
Schmink.
I'm a little slow.
Oop. That's all right.
Schmink was Prussian blue. Oh, you grabbed Prussian green, didn't you?
I did. That's the one I did green first.
Because I noticed how they're right next to each other.
Yeah. Which I love the Prussian green, but we're not doing a comparison on that one, and it's a different color. We should do a lemon color.
Yeah.
Because lemon yellow is like a basic color that you need when you're doing a palette. If you're just doing like basic colors,
mm-hmm.
You need a good blue, a good red, and a good yellow.
So far, even with the pans that weren't as wet anymore, when I got to them, they activate very easily with just a tiny bit of water.
I think that the Kuretake and the Koi can compete very nicely with the other paint brands, and for the price point when you're...
No, that's Daniel Smith, I think.
Yeah,
that's Daniel Smith.
This one. For the price point, when you're just starting out and you're doing art journaling, I think the Koi and the Kuretake are a really good buy when you compare them to the other more expensive brands.
Come on, there we go. I didn't realize at first when I first started using water brushes that when you squeeze it out, it comes out the side before it goes down the bristles. And I put a little too much water, but that's okay because this is a beautiful color. Just cover the whole page.
We don't have lemon yellow, but we have handsome yellow medium.
There's a lemon yellow in the, and I believe
you
have
the lemon. Oh, wait, we have the sample. Wait a minute, hold the phone. I keep forgetting I've got the sample book.
Oh, for Daniel Smith?
Yeah.
Let's see, do you have anything I could use to... Let's see if I can do it with my finger. Okay, this is thick. Okay. Just making sure I'm grabbing the one that I need.
They have lemon yellow.
Oh, nice.
Okay, and then we have...
Trying to do this so the paints don't go everywhere.
The Schmink paints make me want to go back to Germany and visit my husband's family, so I have an excuse to buy paint.
That's funny. Hi, I want to come visit. Bye, I'm going to the store.
I'm going to the Schmink store.
It must be like heaven for you. Have you been to the actual Schmink store there?
No. And I would need one of the relatives to come with me because I don't speak German.
Oh. So I know not everybody speaks English in other countries.
Some of them do and some don't. The
You know what? It's okay if it's wet. Okay.
So we're going to do... in the core, we don't have lemon yellow, but we have this other. I can't read my own writing, but it's bismuth, something yellow, vanadale yellow. I spelled it wrong, see?
It's okay.
Something like that. Mango has a lemon.
So we're doing primaries.
Yeah, let's
did
do
you it. Is that what you were trying to do, primaries?
No, that's an accident.
I just realized, because I understand basic set, and I was thinking, oh, great, wait a minute, we just did primaries, or we're doing primaries. You know what we should do?
We should do a purple, too. Oh, yeah, I agree with that.
I would say pinks, but some of the reds are kind of pinkish.
In my opinion, so. Like, the purple is one of my primaries, because I cannot buy a set that has less than at least 18 colors.
And I've seen lots of videos, because I've been watching a lot of videos on watercolor lately, or at least reviews on watercolors, that people seem to mix purples a lot. And
yep.
Granted, you can still mix some colors in here to make a different purple.
Well, sure, but I hate having to stop and mix purple all the time.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So. And I like a palette that has at least 18 colors in it, so I have a nice variety of colors, a nice dark, a nice light, shades, a couple different shades of each color, and a purple. Like, that's a palette that would make me really happy. Where's that one?
Sorry, you can read upside down, so.
Oh, okay, here. Wait.
No, that's fine. Just keep doing it. I'm going to read upside down.
Dale Smith Lemon Yellow. No, I can already tell you from doing some of these color keys that the one I know I don't like, I'll use it for something because I have the paint, but the one is going to be the Mayberry. It's a little bit chalky.
The yellow is?
The yellow, yeah.
Okay.
It's not as bright.
All right. Let's, after Daniel Smith.
Schmink, and it's a lemon.
I don't know. Spell it. You know what? I'll look at the names on here because... And that's lemon yellow as well?
Yep.
And core.
And it's the one that's bismuth. Bismuth. Vanadale yellow.
Bismuth?
Yeah, something like that.
Bismuth what?
Vanadale yellow, spelled the way it sounds.
And then Van Gogh.
The Van Gogh is a lemon yellow, and the Mayberry is a lemon yellow.
So, core is the only one that isn't a lemon yellow.
Yeah. Because I got a set, so I didn't, like, pick tubes.
Just so you could start off with?
I just wanted...
Start your collection?
Yeah, because I wanted to start a little collection, and I didn't necessarily want all the colors.
Did you get tubes?
Yeah. See, but it's very lemony compared to these other ones. It's a nice color. Looks like I chose well that time. Which isn't always the case.
Okay. All right, so. Your thing's getting stained.
That's all right. They were already stained.
Honestly, the new brush I got, because I had a small one, but
yeah.
The Kurataki, and then... I got a medium one, so I could do a little bigger areas.
Yeah.
Because, I like details, so
yeah,
I'm not going to do a whole lot of big
and
stuff.
And the Kurataki makes a nice, big flat water brush. Like, they don't only make round, they make flats.
I think I got one from you in Happy Meal one time.
Yeah.
So I might bring those two with me, I have to remember.
And that's nice for doing washes. You know, just getting the paper wet or doing a wash of color.
This is Corey.
Yeah, that's Corey. Oh, no, Daniel Smith, sorry.
Daniel Smith?
Yeah, that's Daniel Smith.
Oh, I forgot to do the lines.
Oh, see? Mayberry. See, it's okay. It's just not as bright as, like, even the koi is a really bright lemon yellow. See, there's all of our yellows.
Or to the wise, let your carbon ink dry before you put...
Oh, yeah, because it will react with water if it's not dry. But that being said, yellow pigments in any paint are generally not opaque unless they've been mixed with titanium white. So, generally speaking, any yellow pigment in any paint is going to be pretty translucent,
mm-hmm.
whether it's acrylic or watercolor or anything.
This is a very light yellow.
Yeah.
It's very pretty, though.
I have to say, I think on this card, my favorite yellow is the Schmink Lemon. It's the brightest. Or the Koi.
Yeah.
I like the Mayberry. There's just something, it's different than the others. Yeah, I know it's supposed to be lemon yellow, but...
And what I really like about, or at least from what I've used, because I haven't used much, this is the only time I'm using anything else for right now, but at least with the Kuratakis, they require so little water to activate it
mm-hmm.
that you really can just use a water brush. You don't have to spritz.
You don't have to spritz them first.
It just depends on if you want a more transparent color, you will have to spritz them so you have a little more water.
I like them. My only gripe is the box. I don't like the cardboard box. If you're going to do watercolors, it should be at least in a plastic box. That's like one of my gripes. By that same token, I love the Koi set. It's a great travel set, but again, I'm not a big fan of the box. The outside box is fine, but the inside is this really thin, cheap plastic. And at some point, I can see me taking all the guts out and gluing half pans in here and putting the paint into half pans. Because the guts part of this is just really thin, cheap plastic.
Mm. And that bugs you?
It bugs me.
Alright, so Koi, I'm assuming this is the one?
Yep. No, it's alright.
Now you're going to be editing some of this stuff out anyway.
Of course I will.
Like my face.
Maybe not that.
Thank you for editing out my snorting.
I edited out, like, because we, like, now, we were just, you know, doing a lot of chatting and talking while we were painting, and some of that was private stuff I don't necessarily want any of us to be having aired on YouTube. So, you know, I edited it out.
I like how Anne sent you some of her clips.
She did, yes, and we put them
just
all together.
Just to make it easier, yeah.
I thought it would be easier and then have it shared on all the channels if they wanted. And
I
we
know.
Did the same thing with the upcoming swap video for KIF, where we edited a few different people doing things into one video, and it's going to be aired on multiple channels.
Is it going to be Claudia's music?
No. But it's going to be an ATC swap.
Oh, okay, cool.
Hawaii-themed ATC swap.
Oh, this is a very pretty one.
Isn't that a pretty? I like the Van Gogh palette. They're, you know, overall, I was very happy with this one. My only gripe with this one was it didn't have purple. So I took, I did have some Van Gogh purple, so I added it to the lid.
But the nice thing I like about the, well, watercolors, from what I've seen, you know, the nice thing is that it's always going to react again.
Yep.
So that way you can put it in there and you can reuse this blue. You can reuse this purple.
I don't clean my lid unless it gets, you know, really, really bad. But I generally speaking don't, because all this is still good paint.
Mm-hmm.
And I can just put dollops of colors that I'm missing down here up here when I'm working on something specific. And then if I wanted, I could take this. It's not that big.
Mm-hmm.
And I have my purple in the lid.
All right. So where's the core? Four bismuth.
This one? Yeah, this one.
And there's a little asterisk, right?
Yeah.
Oh, there it is. Oh, you like this color.
Yeah. I do like that color.
If you could see this, it's too small to really see.
There's a hole in it.
The whole thing is a hole.
Yeah.
There's like... You have to, like, really get in there.
So that's how I can tell when I get a new palette and I start playing with it which colors I really like, because they're the ones that get holes in them first. In the Van Gogh palette, which is the one I use the most for YouTube, I've already had to refill the lemon yellow, the Matter Lake Deep, and the Prussian blue. because and
you
I'm gonna
just use the tubes to refill, right?
Yeah, and I have to do the sap green soon too. And the Van Gogh palette is great because it has tube paints that match the same color, so you can just refill from the tube.
Okay, now I need Mamery over there.
Okay.
And then I'm gonna need Schmink. And that's that one.
That one. Yep.
Okay, just permanent yellow lemon.
Yeah.
They mixed up the wording a little bit to get 52.
Well, because I'm sure the Mamery paint's made in Italy.
Yeah.
So that it doesn't exactly translate, and the printing on the tube is really, really, really teeny. So I had to use my, on a couple of the tubes, I had to use my reading glasses and my magnifier to read the name of the paint because it was really, really small.
Now, what do you prefer for size size of pans? Because I'm assuming it depends on what type of watercolor painting you're doing. Like,
yeah.
If you're doing a big piece or if you're doing a little bit, like, little pieces. Like,
if I'm... I don't mind the half pans. I would rather sacrifice having a big pan of paint to have a lot of colors than having a smaller palette with big pans in it.
Okay.
But if it has the big pans, it has to be a palette of, like, this one of at least 24... 18 to 24, otherwise I'm just not happy because there's not enough of a color selection for me.
Okay. Well, yeah, we all know that you love your color.
Yeah.
And this one is contaminated. This lemon yellow.
Oh, it is.
Looks like there's a bit of green in it.
Oh, yeah, not surprised. I'm a sloppy painter.
I am too much of a perfectionist. Looking at that, screaming inside.
Yeah, she does that with a lot of my stuff because I'm messy.
Oh, I don't care that she keeps it that way, but I see that and it makes me want to fix it. But I'm not going to because it's her stuff. And
no,
if you
I always offer to let her clean my stuff, but you know.
I'll just use up the paint. That's, you know. So we are doing purples?
Yeah, let's do purple.
Okay. Do you want to do, are we just doing a straight purple? Because there are two purples in the larger set of the Kurataki.
Well, let's just do a straight purple because I don't think we have lots of choices, and we...
Okay.
I don't know that we even have the right color purple in all of them.
Okay.
Let's see. Schmink.
Just see what we... Get the closest comparisons we can.
Yeah.
I'm gonna make sure... Oh, my phone's right here. Make sure. All these... requests for games.
I turned all those off. I hate that.
I just don't go on the browser in my on my laptop anymore. I usually just use the app. And I'm too lazy to go through and block them. I just ignore those. If it's a game that I don't want to play, which most of them I don't, I switch around.
So, Schmink only has manganese violet in this palette that I have. I'm sure they make other purples, but that's... I can't afford them.
You have a purple in the palette.
Hey, Mary.
That's what's important.
Exactly, see?
I would mix, but I probably would want to use purple. I really like purple. Oh, that's what I should have gotten. I was at Walmart. I should have seen if I could find a mixing tray. For travel.
So the Van Gogh one is in here in the lid. That's the purple. Mm-hmm. It's actually blue violet. It's over here too, but
okay. It's not on here.
And Quar, we only have one color, dioxazine purple.
Oh, that's the best one.
Yeah.
I love that color.
It's not on there because I added it last, and I just have never gotten around to making a new color key.
Oh, okay. Did you recognize this plastic casing?
Yes.
I reused it. Don't throw it away, right?
Yeah, no, don't throw it away. There's nothing wrong with it.
It's useful. All right, so Koi is just purple. Kurataki is just purple. Daniel Smith is Quint purple. I even say Quinn. I don't even say the whole thing out.
But Aquanome Purple. I don't even know if I say it right, but yeah. A lot of your art supply stores throughout the year will have demonstrations on the weekend. And if it's a watercolor or other paint company, like even Golden, if you go to the demos, which are usually free, you get samples.
Mm.
Free. So that's a great way to acquire a few different little things. Like when I went to the Schmink, Sennelier demo. It was a Sennelier demo, and I got three tubes of Sennelier watercolor. I got Sonaris Blue, Opera Rose, which I love that color, and light yellow, which is a fabulous color. And then Schmink sent me free samples, and they sent me a lemon yellow, and I want to say they sent me a red too. Yeah, ruby red.
You need to do the line.
So. Oh yeah. So don't be afraid to go to these demos or write to some of these companies and ask them if they've got samples. Quar has their sample little booklets, and Daniel Smith, you have to pay for it, but you can get all over 200 color sample dot sheets of all their colors. It's like $25 on their website.
Wow, you can make that go a long way.
Exactly. The dots are decent size, and if you're doing just art journal pages or ATC cards, those little dots of paint will go a long way.
Or if you're like me, I love doodling, so if I do in a doodle and you want to color in like little details like that, then
it's going to go a long way.
I love that purple and yellow are on the same sheet for me. They just complement each other so well.
Yep.
Oh, and this is why it's so important to do a color key, I've learned. So you see this purple? This is what it looks like in the pan.
Exactly.
It looks black.
That's why you need to do a color key before you do anything.
I wouldn't be able to... I would be like, I don't know what I'm doing. Oh, crap, that's not the right color. Gonna start over, you know?
Yep. I've done that.
Koi.
This is the koi, yeah. That's nice.
Color. Oh, that is
isn't it a nice
gorgeous.
Color?
It's more of a red purple.
Yeah. So the Van Gogh is more of a blue purple.
Okay. I really do like the Kurataki, but I like I think because pink is my favorite color, so the closer it is to pink, the happier it makes me.
Okay, so the Kurataki purple is much closer to the Van Gogh purple than it is to the Koi purple, because it's more of a blue purple.
Oh, you're right.
I can tell you that just by putting it on here without blending it out.
The Van Gogh is a little bit darker.
Yeah.
It is a little deeper.
I didn't get too much of it on here. Yeah, there you go. It's a little bit grayer, too.
Yeah. Noticed that, too. I'm going to put a little more pigment on my Kurataki because I didn't spray it. Have more of a gradation on here.
The right color? That doesn't look like the right color. I did it again.
You did like a red, like a deep red or something.
Yeah, I got the color next to it. So I'm just lifting, and you won't get it all out because this purple is a color that's going to stain. But I can get some of it. I can lift some of it.
The majority.
Just getting
of it
wet, yeah.
And this is Schmink.
Okay, this is Daniel Smith, and okay. I just picked the wrong color. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
I guess that's the thing about having the tiny half pans is you have to really
count. You have to count. And I might have gotten the right color. I should just, you know, make sure. That... Oh, no, that was the right color. It's a lot more red than the others.
And it's Quinn Purple?
Yeah. I got it right the first time. Okay. Look at that. Isn't that just pretty? Like,
I wonder if something about quinacridone is like a reddish color. Maybe that.
Maybe that. That's the nature of that pigment. I don't know enough about pigments. This one's manganese violet in the Schmink paint.
That is a gorgeous color. Oh my goodness.
Isn't it pretty?
Just spreading it out and the smoothness of it is just...
I think so far of all the purples on here, I think it's my favorite.
Oh, I can't wait to play with the palette. That...
So, core... Ooh, wow, that's so dark.
Add some water. It's watercolor.
Yeah. Oh, it's very blue. It's more like the Kuretake purple. It's a very blue purple.
I think I've made up my mind. I think I really do like the cold press better. The smooth is really nice.
It's nice, but it's very smooth, and I like the texture.
And I feel like you get a better color on the cold. Or maybe you're just picking up the... more pigment.
Well, it sticks in the texture of the paper. It doesn't just sit on the top and soak in.
And then soak sticks. In and then look weird.
Yeah.
This is... Oh, core. You have lots of... I saw big pans of the yellow on the bottom because it's a common color you use, or...
Yeah, and that was one of the samples I got, and it was in a tube that wasn't resealable.
Okay.
So I had to dump it all out, and there was too much for one pan.
Oh, for a small pan?
Yeah.
Okay, I grabbed a little, I didn't realize how much I had grabbed for the core, and, oops. Not really, because it's beautiful. I'll just keep spreading it out. I don't want to waste it.
Okay, that core purple sure is pretty. I gotta tell you.
That's what I'm saying. I'm doing right now. I
on the Daniel Smith.
I grabbed too much on my on the core.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah. Wow.
I didn't realize how much I grabbed. I'm like, doo doo. Oh, oops. Because you had just gotten it wet, so.
That's a pretty color chart.
Mine's a little awkward looking, but whatever.
You need this one, maybe.
It makes me happy. Yes, please. Makes me happy. Star down in the
place. Yes.
I'm noticing that you need a lot less. Even though these react very well and they're very highly pigmented.
The tube paints will always be more pigmented because of the nature of the paint. So with the tubes, you tend to need a lot less of it to get the color reaction that you want than any kind of cake pre-poured thing.
Yeah, I was going to say, it's just, I noticed that it's like, I think that's why I'm grabbing so much without realizing because I'm used to the hard.
And then there's, when you start upgrading your paints, there's some things you want to think about, like the Sennelier paints, and I have some in this palette here. Sennelier, because the binder is honey, never really dries in the pan. It's always sticky.
Oh, I remember you saying that.
Yeah, so you want to be conscious of that. And that, for me, that's another reason for me to not have lots of Sennelier tube paint, because that kind of makes me crazy.
Okay. This is a very, very, very light color.
Yeah.
I noticed that it lifts much better off of hard press.
The Mayberry?
No, just... The watercolor. Probably because you don't have the texture for it to get soaked into. Okay.
That's pretty.
It's good to know, though. That is really pretty. How'd you get yours so dark? Mine's so, like, light.
I added a couple of coats. I kept picking up more paint.
And I squeezed out a little too much water. Yeah, that's good enough.
Yeah.
I just like to see the... not like I'm gonna, you know, but when I come over again, I'll know which ones
which
I want.
One you do?
I just
still
need
schmink. This one. Well, and doing this will help you, Sarah, when you do decide to, or if you do decide to buy more watercolor, this will help you decide which ones you maybe want to gravitate towards.
Yeah.
And
I will say that I do like the way schmink goes on.
Yep.
And
the artist paints, you don't have to just right away go buy a set. Like my Daniel Smith collection, I started out just buying one tube at a time.
How much are they per tube?
The Daniel Smith run about like $10 to $20 a tube, depending on the color and the pigments used to make the color. Some of them cost more money.
Kind of like anything,
like any paints. Art, like any artist paints, yeah. The golden acrylic paints run are the same way. Like some of their series ones, like cheaper than the series four.
And Daniel Smith is carried almost.
Almost everywhere.
All art stores.
Yep.
Okay.
At least around here, because they're made in the USA.
At least they are. I mean, other ones would be a little harder to find, I'm sure, but...
Yeah.
But these are more affordable than Schmink.
Yeah.
You said they're...
Schmink 2, though, you can buy... I bought this as a 48-pan set, but Schmink you can also buy just per tube. And I think per tube the cost is about the same as Daniel Smith. But in... the San Francisco Bay Area where we are, the only place I know for sure that has Schmink and Daniel Smith is Lens Art in Santa Cruz. There may be another store locally that has both, but not that I have found.
Okay.
Like, University Art has Daniel Smith, but they don't have Schmink.
Okay.
So then you can just take one of your sets and just start playing, like, the Kurosaki set.
Want any colors that you don't have? Let me know.
Okay, I think I got a lot of color.
Well, I know you do.
I'm gonna start by just putting water on my paper and get my paper wet. So you just get your paper wet and start dropping in color into the wet part. And I'm gonna just blot a little bit. Blot. We don't just call it blotting. It's lifting. Blotting is a no-no word. Okay. So then I'm gonna take. Another color, and for these kind of color experiments where you're working wet on wet to just see what you can get your watercolor paint to do, and just you're just really playing with the water and the puddling, and you don't have to necessarily worry about complementary colors, or if you make mud, you know, oh well, you're just playing. So I'm gonna pick wine red, and it's going to stay with the water, and it's going to just blend with the other paints I have on here. And you can kind of make it do what you want by dropping more water on there. And you can make one color bloom into the other one. You can tilt it and make it drip. And this is a great fun way to just do backgrounds for written journals or mixed media journal. You could do collage on top of it. Just be aware that the watercolor paint might still move. Don't you love that turquoise color? Isn't it great?
Oh, the turquoise.
Is it cobalt blue?
This is cobalt blue.
Yeah, I like that color. So it's a little bit pale, so I want to add some dark spots.
I like the effect it has. This is buckling way too much, but whatever, I'm just playing.
Yeah.
But I like when it, what is it called? When it
blooms it one color into the other? This is exactly how I did this one. By the way.
Or even how it pushes the other color out when you add it to, like, an existing pool.
Yeah, it pushes it out. You can also, while this is wet, if you have it gotten all your color on there and it's still wet, you can drop some table salt in certain places, and that will absorb all the water and pigment.
Yeah, I've seen people use that before. That's awesome.
Yeah, it leaves a really cool texture.
And of course, blue, pink, and purple, and yellow are like some of my favorite colors to use together. It's interesting seeing these together. This is, I don't think you have this color. in your set, but even so, just seeing
how they mix together or don't mix
or
together.
Or how they just react with this paper.
Yeah. Well, yeah, because that's hot press. I found that I'm, you know, it's okay.
I'll probably,
but it's
just
not
by
my
playing
favorite.
Now, I have a feeling I'll probably stick with cold press for the most part.
Yeah.
But this is definitely going to get used.
Yeah, I mean, I have some more hot press, so I'll use it, but it's not my favorite.
Mm-hmm.
So then I just start to look at the design on the page and see if there's areas I want to define and make more prominent than others. Maybe someplace that needs some... light. Yellow is a good color for hinting at sunlight.
This page
give you some
so
warm
much
spots.
Water.
I went to a paper demo at Lens Art and I got samples of paper. That was really cool. It was a Fabriano demo.
Oh.
So I got samples, and that's where I learned about the soft press paper.
Because
I have Fabriano cold press. I did not know Fabriano made a soft press.
Yeah, this is, all the colors come off very easily off of hot press. I don't know if I like that. Because sometimes you might want to pick some up because there's too much water.
Right, but not all of it.
But yeah, this is very, very much picking up a lot of it, so I think that I would... if I'm going to be serious about doing something on the hot press, or at least this specific one, then I think I would probably make sure that I don't use too much water where I want to pick up. I don't know.
But
I mean,
see,
it's watercolor. You can always add more, but...
You can, but that's a good thing to know by just playing and experimenting and trying things. And it's
mm-hmm.
a great thing to find out if you get, you know, go to some of these demos and you get these free samples of paper and you can just try them
mm-hmm.
before you buy a whole stack of paper and then discover you don't like it. Because I know I don't have the budget for that.
I have a feeling my pinks are going to go out first.
I love the turquoise green is a pretty color.
Sorry, this pink looks really, really bright next to the deep pink and the purple and the blue. Don't mind me. Oh, good, they can't see my face.
No, no. They're just looking at my hands.
I'm having a bit of a... can't say that
word.
Never mind.
She's melting down over here because she's in love with the pink color. That's all we can say about that. I have some 12-year-old viewers, so...
Yeah, that's why I stopped myself. I wanted to say a certain word, but I wasn't going to. Plus, it's public. I
yeah,
don't want to
yeah,
put that out in public.
That,
and
that too.
Even if you didn't have any 12-year-old viewers.
So now I'm just, you know, kind of... I don't know, it has sort of a geometric feel here, so I'm just emphasizing that and highlighting certain areas and putting more color until I get something I like.
I'm just putting color down and watching it move around.
Sarah's just playing, but that's the way you learn, is just to play and move the color around and see what it'll do. And
I have no idea what this is.
How it'll blend. You're not focused on making anything that you
know
what
know.
It is.
It's just, I don't know what it's going to turn into eventually. I guess I'll see what happens. But yes, this color does look amazing with the other ones. And since I'm not as serious about watercolor, I have a feeling that these are going to last me forever.
And just get something like that. You could use it on your own, on its own for a page or a painting. You could put a quote on top of it. You could cut it up for embellishments. You could scan it.
Doodle over it.
You could doodle over it. They're great to doodle over.
Cut it up into inches.
Yep. Yep.
Ugh. Sorry. Me and my doodle obsessions. Gotten re-inspired to start doodling again,
yeah.
So.
There's this one, and there's this one I did the other day.
a light brown. It's a yellow ochre, not light brown.
Yeah.
I wanted to just write yellow ochre, but that's not what they call it.
These are all done the same way. They're just playing with the paint and the pigment and... Do you want to try metallics? Oh, maybe. Keep playing with your paint.
I'm just telling you, yeah.
I know, because the big set has metallics in it, and the little one doesn't. That's one of the main differences. Has a few other colors, but the main difference is the metallics. Now, the schmink set comes with metallics.
Oh,
and this one is just what Sarah's doing. She's just putting color on the page and moving it around, puddling it. And that by itself is a cute background for, like, doodling on top of. And this particular one would be a cute bookmark. And here's my chicken, my first attempt at a expressive chicken. But he needs help. I need to practice my chickens.
Let me see. Better than I would do it, especially first try.
It's not that good.
Shh. You know how long it would take me? How long did it take for you to do this?
I don't know, 20 minutes.
Yeah. Me, perfectionist.
It's almost out of water.
Okay, pale aqua next to purple. This may or may not go well.
You can also lift with your brush.
That's true. Like, try to...
You can just, yep, and then dab it off on the...
I'm gonna do this.
But if you have a lot of it, then you need to do it that way, yeah.
Yeah.
And I almost always watercolor with a rag or a paper towel in my hand for lifting. Here's another paper towel if you need it.
Bright.
The Kuretake colors are really nice, and they're bright. And this one was done with the Kuretake. This one, I think, I did with the Van Gogh palette.
Yeah.
So, this is artist grade watercolor, and this is student grade. So, at least I think the Kuretake may be artist grade Japanese watercolors, but I don't think so. I haven't read anything that says that.
I haven't read anything anywhere that says the grade. Light,
no.
Fastness, anything.
No.
So, I mean, they could be professional, they could be student grade.
Yeah.
It's
but
kind of...
The information's hard to find, and I don't remember looking at these.
You really shouldn't, from what I've read, you really shouldn't try to compare them completely with, and you'd have to tell me this because you're the watercolor artist, but with traditional Western watercolors because
they're different.
Very different.
They're different.
They're not going to... compare, quote unquote, you know. Yes, they're going to have very different qualities.
So in the literature from Jackson's, it says traditional Japanese watercolors for professional artists and crafters alike. That usually means that it's some sort of high grade student quality or artist quality paint, and comparable to the Van Gogh set. Which I could already tell you that without looking at the literature by looking at these two abstracts.
Oh, says Van Gogh in there? I didn't
know. No. It didn't. That's my opinion.
Oh, okay.
But I could tell you that it's comparable to this Van Gogh set, which is an artist grade, but it's not, you know, top of the line or anything.
Mm-hmm.
But looking at these two abstracts, in my opinion, looking at these two, and this one's done on hot press, granted, but I think the color of the pigments is very comparable between the two.
Yeah.
And the Kuretake is a lot cheaper.
Yeah. I mean, they have some colors that I don't know, like, if you've seen any of the Kuretake colors in other brands before, but can you use the bigger brush?
Oh, yeah. This one?
Yeah, I'm just going to do kind of color around it. Oh, this is...
Oh, here. This is the bigger one. You just need to change the barrel because it's empty. So put this barrel on it because this is full.
Oh, you've switched it because of...
No, I was using the big one. I just used all the water.
Oh, okay.
Used it up.
Because I was just going to do like a little bit of yellow around it or whatever. Oh,
but
right. This one, you got to put in some hot water.
Yeah. It's a little bit. I think I put the cap on funny.
Oh. That's gonna bug me.
What?
I'll do it. I'll fix it. I got some green or something in there.
Uh-oh.
How did I already...
High performance paints ideal for sketching, illustration, sumi, manga, calligraphy, and more.
So they're fairly versatile.
Yep. And they're affordable. That's the thing I like. Plus, you can get half pan refills of all of the colors. You can get refill tubes for the koi, but they're not as easily obtainable, and you can't get all the colors. So.
Oh, this is awesome.
See, look at that. And see the blooming there where you have the red and purple that's blooming into the yellow? That's fabulous. And that's the way you learn about, you know, what you can and can't do with your watercolor paints.
Mm-hmm. I'm just putting a little here so I can grab some yellow and move it around the way I want to without getting too much pigment and colors.
You just want to remember with your watercolors that you need to think of the fact that you're working from light to dark. So if you want light areas, you need to leave them lightly colored. If you want white areas, you need to leave them plain paper. Or you need to know that you're going back over it with a white, since you're doing mixed media, a white gel pen or a white paint pen or a white acrylic paint or a mm-hmm. white gouache. Because you can't really, most of your colors stain. So you can't count on being able to lift the color up.
Okay.
And since we can't find any information on the staining properties of the Kuretake, we don't know. I mean, I guess you could test all the colors like you're doing now and then see which ones will lift cleanly and which ones won't. My guess is most of them won't lift completely. And the darker the color, the less likely you're going to get a lot of it to lift.
Okay.
Generally speaking, in my experience, that's how it works. The really dark colors don't lift very much. The lighter colors, you can usually lift almost all of it.
See, some of the colors are already dried, so they don't bloom as easily. But
right.
I saw that happen, and I was like, even the purple, it didn't really create that much mud.
Yeah.
But there's also less pigment. So this yellow is very, very light.
And sometimes those unexpected areas of mud are nice.
Peter might cringe.
Well.
Love you, Peter.
Love you, Pita.
And I love her, because when I have a question about something, if she has the time, then, and she's able to help me, I know that she's going to tell me in a way that, you know, she likes the things be done. And if I'm asking her, it's because I want to know her opinion and
exactly.
how she likes it done.
Exactly.
So...
Whereas I usually answer the question with a question by saying, well, what do you want to see happen?
Okay, do you see what just happened?
Yeah.
Purple, blue, no, wait, that was, I think, one of the darker purples, the deep pink, the dark pink, and the cobalt blue mixed in to make this amazing color with the yellow.
Don't tilt it, because you're going
to
mess it up.
I know, I'm trying to show you.
It's fabulous.
Now that I'm adding more color around the side, it makes me feel a little better. I'm like, it's just in the middle with nothing. I'll probably doodle on it or something, to be honest.
Sometimes I just do these abstract backgrounds and then I just leave them sit and I doodle on them, or I stamp on top of them sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes I'll stamp a quote on top of something.
You make
like this.
Really nice tags out of them.
Yeah,
too,
yeah,
I guess.
Yeah. And even these sample, you know, cards, if you were going to make a bunch of these sample cards and then you didn't have a reference book to put them in, you know, this could be cut up for embellishments.
Mm-hmm. Do you tend to turn your work much? I know I've watched you before and it doesn't ever seem like you do, but I'm wondering if...
I do.
Is that because you know you're filming or...
I do turn my work a lot, but not usually when I'm filming. Except for today, earlier today, I started a new painting series, and for that I did turn my work. Because we were working on a background, and it was abstract. We're going to be doing a Journaling by Fives inspired Monday with Deco Art series that involves working on a canvas in 15-minute increments, doing different things on the canvas.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah.
Sounds like it'll be fun.
And we're not, you know, shooting for doing, you know, a landscape or a face or, you know, anything like that. Unless, of course, it's what they want to do.
Uh-huh.
Oh, I got to take this. It's my mom. Hello? Hi.
You should have tried scarlet red. That is really an orange.
And well, so then you can orange. You can make some of it like blue.
Uh-huh.
Into the other, but not all of it. So you have these little few just a few little spots of blue.
I just realized there's no actual orange in that set, is there?
No. The closest orange
is the scarlet red.
The closest one in the small set. But you have, you have two oranges.
I have an actual orange.
Yeah.
Because that's more, I mean, it's more of a yellow orange.
But,
A red orange.
Orange is, at least for me, it seems like it's easier for me to mix the right orange that I want than it is the right purple that I want. And that's just something about me, I think.
Mm-hmm. What color are you using there?
This is the scarlet red.
Oh, okay. As I say, an orange would be really nice with that blue. Or green. The turquoise.
That color.
It's a mixture of blue and green.
Yep. And so. Not tons of water in my brush.
Yeah, see, if I did that on this paper, it would have immediately pulled up, like, almost all of it.
See, I really like cold press. Cold press is my thing. I like the texture.
Mm-hmm. I think I'll save the hot press, honestly, for either if I just want to be messy and
well,
don't care where it goes.
It's good to doodle on the hot press.
I was going to say, because of the smoothness,
right?
I can use it to doodle on.
Like Zentangling, I could see Zentangling on the hot press.
Mm-hmm. I was going to say, do that, doodle, and then color in with the watercolor.
Yeah.
Or with Inktense pencils.
Yeah.
Something that I would want a little more control, like have small areas I don't need as much water with, because the more water it seems like the look. And it's fine. I like how messy you can get with it, but.
But these Kuretake paints are really well pigmented, I think, and they're a good buy, and I know the small sets carried at Hobby Lobby. And they have them at, of course, Amazon and a bunch of other places. I got mine at Hobby Lobby with a coupon.
The 36 set is also $40 on Amazon.
That's nice. That's a good deal.
I think it was cheaper than the 24 set at Hobby Lobby. Or maybe the same price. Without the coupon,
I just got
of
blue in my red. Oh, that's all right.
You got purple!
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. You can see it's already...
Yeah.
Whatever.
Arches, watercolor... I like the fluid watercolor blocks because they're affordable and they come in a lot of really great sizes for traveling, like the 4x6.
Mm-hmm.
But they're not attached on three sides. They're only attached on two. Arches are attached on, like, 3.5 sides. And they have a little, like, 2-inch opening on
like,
one side to stick... So, because it's glued down more, it warps even less.
Okay.
But it's more expensive.
Yeah, because if this was even just on this side, you would only be worried of, like, only this part.
Yeah, and you notice...
It is fine because I'm not, like, doing, like, fine art pieces or anything.
No, and this is 140-pound Strathmore paper, and you notice that it's not, obviously... blocked down or anything, and I got it a little bit wet. It's a little bit warped in the middle. I don't know if anybody can see that.
Is that 400 series? I'm not good with the pad.
No, this is actually the yellow pad, which is, what is that, 300?
300, I think. Student grade.
Okay. Yeah, so it warped a little bit, but not too much, and most of the time when I'm just doing these kind of little practice pieces,
mm-hmm.
you know, they curl a little bit, but that doesn't bother me. It's only when I'm working on, like, something more important, bigger,
mm-hmm.
that I want to work on a block. But I like the convenience of having the small blocks when I'm traveling,
mm-hmm.
instead of, like, tons of, like, loose pieces of paper. That's annoying. I don't like that.
Unless it's, you know, in the binder.
Yeah. Yes, or in a book, like I love this bag. This is the bag I ordered.
Did you show that on video yet?
Not yet. Ooh. This is the Tom Din bag, and they don't make it anymore. It's the Field Journal Kit. They do have a few left in old stock. So you have to email them or call them.
Yeah, I don't think... You hadn't put this together yet in that video.
No, and so this is the red color. And it has a pocket here in the front. And in here I have a mixing palette. And it has another pocket in the back, which is where usually my Peerless palette is, but it's over there right now. And then inside it has all of these little spaces for brushes. And
I'm trying to get it into the frame so they can see better.
Oh, there we go. For brushes. Thank you, Sarah. For brushes. And then I've got my Winsor Newton set here, which I had to, you know, add more colors to because I didn't have enough dark colors. It came with this little ruler, which is cute. I put in a zippered pouch from a planner that I had, and I put some brushes and pencils in here along with a couple of Tim Holtz Mini Misters. And then I have another little pouch that has some of the Quar sample booklets. Because, you know, the one set of paint's not enough.
Oh, and the color chart.
And it has a color wheel, yeah.
Or a color wheel.
Always with the color wheel.
Oh, I found my small color wheel. I'm going to have to add that to my travel kit.
There you go. I have a sheet protector here because I do want to stick either a finished piece of artwork or I want to be able to put maybe some traveling ephemera in there or something. And it came with this plastic protector. I found this.
Batteries low.
Oh, yeah. I found this.
That's beautiful.
Bookmark thing yesterday at Staples. And then I put watercolor paper in it, and I've got a couple rags.
And is love this guy. Is that the yellow pad as well? Watercolor
this
paper?
This is yellow pad Strathmore 300 series. It's 300 series.
I believe so.
Yeah,
I believe so. I don't quote me on that, but I do believe so. Because I know I like the 400 just in all their papers, just because it seems to hold up a little better to whatever you're doing. Of course, I'd prefer the 500, but it's very hard to find if, unless you're ordering it online or something.
Yeah.
But I do have a 500 series mixed media journal, and it's amazing. Oh.
That outlet's funny over there.
It doesn't know what to do.
No, it's blinking.
Did you pause it?
No, I'm going to shut it off, and I'll do... I have an ending I do now. I made myself a script because I kept forgetting half of what I was supposed to be saying. I don't say the whole angel policy part, but I do have to mention a lot of that.
Oh, because of you're using people, different companies' products, or... Because of your work, you don't want people copying you?
Both.
Both. Okay.
Both.
Just to protect everybody involved.
Yep. Because I do not want to be
you're
one
using
of these.
Daniel Smith in the thing. You don't want people to think they're yours. Or, like, they're into the company.
Or Daniel Smith to think that I'm doing something wrong with their brand. You know, they own the intellectual right to that brand and their products. And I don't want them to think that I'm, you know, doing anything with their product that would... even hint at people that that's mine. You also, when you're doing mixed media, you're using lots of like different pieces of paper and collage items from different companies. I don't want people to think that's my artwork. It's not. It's, you know, tissue paper from Target and, you know,
yeah,
whatever.
You don't always remember the company that made it.
No, so I want to make sure I have like a general disclaimer in
there.
That's
a good idea.
Yeah.
Because I did notice that you put those up recently.
Yeah.
And even though you put your collage video, your videos, even though you updated all of them, people, I noticed, I don't know,
they're
you
still
saw
asking.
This, right?
They're still
it
asking.
It was like,
oh,
you know, a couple of days before I had noticed it, that she'd done it, but I saw it and I was like, Gina hasn't seen it yet.
Yeah. I did.
I'll help her out and I'll
I did find the YouTube Studio Creator app because of Shannon Green, and that's been fabulous because I can be on my phone now and I can open the Creator app and reply to the comments on my phone effectively, easily with the one app without having to like fish around everywhere. It was really a pain without the app. So
the what?
It's a YouTube Studio Creator app, which like nobody knows about, and it's just for YouTube creators. And you can go in there and you can get your dashboard, you can find out how many subscribers you have, look at all your analytics, reply to all your viewer comments.
The YouTube app lets you, I don't know about analytics, what are analytics again?
Those are like how many, which videos are being watched and for how long.
Okay.
And all
I don't
of that
know
stuff.
If the actual YouTube app can do that, but you can reply to comments.
Yeah, but you can't see all the comments. It was hard to find the comments without going to each video. See, with this app, I can just go to one place and look at all the comments on all my videos.
Oh, and it just separates them by video and as long
no,
as
it just
know?
It just separates them by newest to oldest.
Oh, so it's as if they were just putting
it's
it on
It's just like
wall.
It's a message thread, like it's an email box.
It
yeah.
doesn't confuse you?
No, it's
I would
easier.
Need a,
it's
I need,
easier
I
than,
a sense of...
When you get to a certain point with your YouTube channel, and when you start having a lot of comments, it's easier than going to this video and then answering them, and then this video and then answering them, and then this video and answering them. Because I was doing that, and it's a big pain in the neck. And it's
I guess when you're
hard.
When you're getting big and you have more
yeah,
and more videos
and
more and more.
Yeah, when you're little, it's not bad. But when you start to get past a certain point where you're not little anymore, it's really hard. And going to this app, you can just see all of your comments in
okay.
one
that
thread.
Makes sense.
And then you can reply to them all, and it's really, really easy. I love that.
But what if they ask a question specific to a video and you're not sure what it...
Oh, that's happened. I go back and watch the video.
So that actually doesn't save
question,
on time.
Well, not in that case, but that does happen a few times, and that's just because of... I just figure that's me. Sometimes people ask about something I've done in a video, and I don't remember exactly what I did.
Mm.
So occasionally I do have to go back and watch a video because I don't remember.
I would probably have to as well.
It doesn't happen a lot, but it does happen.
I have a good memory sometimes. It depends on what it's pertaining to.
Yeah, and it does. It like I said, it doesn't happen a lot, but it does happen. And I didn't say anything to my mom about Bob's test because it won't serve any purpose to do that. She'll just get worried and drive me crazy.
You're saying handmade items with your images, not mechanically or mass-produced. Is that because you could end up making a lot more money off of stuff that with your artwork in it?
I don't want them to make money off something with my artwork on it.
But you said you could do it with handmade items.
Yes. But
and it could still make money that way.
Yes, but if they're mass producing them or mechanically producing them, they're going to make millions of them, and
mm-hmm.
then I get no money. That's not okay with me.
Yeah,
you're making a couple hundred of them for a craft show. I'm okay with that.
Okay, no,
yeah.
I was going to say
because
okay,
I'm a former craft
sense.
Show person, so totally I'm okay with that.
Because it happens, and it's just you
yep,
know your
yep.
images get out there. People,
but if you're going to start manufacturing things with my image on them, that I'm totally not okay with that.
Artwork. The more I get into art, the more I realize how easy it is to essentially steal someone's work without realizing it.
Mm-hmm.
Because they might put an image out there, but there's no...
People are freaking out about the possible changes in copyright law, and for the average artist, it's not going to make any difference because people have the ability to steal your stuff now. And for the most of us, we can't do anything about it because we don't have the money to go buy hire a copyright attorney,
mm-hmm.
and fight whoever it was.
So what's the
and if the person's
copyright
in,
law?
And if the person's in Asia, and they steal an image or a copyright of yours that you have over here, you almost have no recourse.
How are you going to find out anyways, though?
It
depends on what
it depends. But there are ways. My husband works for a multi-billion-dollar company.
Mm-hmm.
And they make capital semiconductor equipment. And there's a company in Asia that stole their software. And they don't have much recourse. They're trying, but because it's in, I think it's in China, because it's an Asian company, they only have so much rights in international copyright law, and China has a really big history of just not listening to that. They don't care.
Well, they own our company. I mean, our country.
Yeah, yeah.
Practically.
Yeah. So, you know, if they can't...
They're majority shareholders, let's
yeah.
put it that way.
So if they can't do anything about it, you know, what recourse do I have? So, I mean, I can, you know, take all the precautions, and I will,
so
but...
So what's the copyright law, what part of it that's changing that are freaking...
Meridell Abrams has a big thread about it in the YouTube creator Facebook page. Something about the U.S. government wanting to make digital images and artwork
I know what you're talking about. Creative licensing or something like that?
Yeah, something like that. Like, it's a free, like, if you posted it on social media, then anybody can use it, basically. Unless you've filed an actual copyright on the image. Like, there won't be any more implied copyright. Because right now we have, like, an implied copyright. So if somebody stole an image of mine off the internet, but I can say, I have that, I can prove I made that, I've got the painting hanging on my wall, I can make them stop.
They could get it and mass produce it.
Right.
Make millions off of
it.
No.
Right.
That's not right.
Right. That's what they're trying to do. Change it to.
I understand people freaking out.
They're
because you spend all this money, you're putting the work into it.
Yep.
And then you know there are people out there that already do
it. Well, they're already doing it, yeah.
They already do it, but we'll do it even more because they'll know they can get away with it.
Yep.
Oh, but it's my right. Well, I don't understand how people can do that to other people.
There's an artist, I think, in New York that takes people's Instagram postings and he copies them and blows them up huge and sells them as prints in galleries, like nationwide. And he's been taken to court and he won.
Like, does he claim them as his own?
No. But he shouldn't necessarily have the right to sell them either.
No. Because he's not giving the money to anybody else.
Yeah. I don't understand all the parameters about it, but he won.
I've downloaded pictures from the internet or used them
as... I have, too, for inspiration or like
inspiration,
some of the memes
or
sometimes.
I don't know if I showed you. Yeah, I put it on Crazy Island Family. I'm still working on it.
It's my house phone. Ignore it.
Something
you downloaded, Crazy Island.
Remember how Heidi has been doing a lot of like intense work?
Mm-hmm.
I wanted to do, you know what? I'll start with my favorite flower. It's fairly simple. Well, for me, it's fairly simple because I already know it. I've already colored them with different media.
Right.
But with ink tents, I haven't done that yet. So I wanted to, or at least on watercolor paper without any on top of like gesso or something. Bare, you know. So I googled some images so I wouldn't have to, because I can draw them myself. They're fairly simple, but I do much better when I have reference because I'm a visual person.
Right.
So I googled an image. I found one that I really liked. It's got like four or five of them on there and I sketched it out lightly and then drew the lines a lot darker. So that way when I erased them, there would still be a line there, but I knew that you wouldn't be able to see it once I put the ink tents on.
Okay.
You know? So I didn't do it exactly because, you know, it's very obvious. If you put the two next to each other, it's very obvious the same thing. I didn't do all the lines exact. But, you know, on calla lilies, they're very rugged. The edges are very rugged.
Yeah.
So I'm just like, okay, whatever. This is where the flower is. Okay.
Yeah.
I did that. But it's very obvious. It's
where the inspiration came from. Yeah.
But, you know, I put them in the same positions. I put, you know, the same amount of flowers and stuff like that. It was just doing that. I wanted to get pretty flowers down so that way I could play with colors because it's just easier for me. Well, those flowers are fairly easy, I feel.
Yeah.
To,
I like flowers are a good thing to learn to paint with because there's a lot less anxiety about having it be perfect because flowers aren't perfect.
Mm-hmm.
They're very
That's
organic
another thing
in
that
their
I
nature,
love about
so.
Calla lilies because they're... You know, they got the really long stems.
Yeah.
And they look like they should just fall over and break.
Yeah.
They look very fragile.
Yeah.
But they're so strong.
Yeah.
And they're just so elegant looking.
Yeah.
And just not perfect. It's just, I don't know.
Yeah.
I just love it.
I love painting flowers.
I love all flowers.
Almost any kind.
I love all flowers. My least favorite, I would probably say carnations.
They're common.
But I think it's so, because they're so common.
I like carnations. I don't like the fakely, I don't like any flowers that are fake dyed flowers.
Mm.
You know, where they've dyed them with food coloring or something. I don't like that.
I normally don't either. The only reason why I brought them that time to that party that time. Is
well, those
because
were pretty, but yeah.
I only brought them because they were, you know, the colors.
Yeah.
I was like, oh, Because I wanted to get like sunflowers. I don't know, I was feeling sunflowers that day. But they didn't really have
a bunch of sunflowers. Safeway's had some really pretty sunflowers, which surprised me.
But for some reason, my Safeway was like, some of them, they were already browning on the edges. Not terrible.
Which Safeway do you go to? There's the one on Cochrane and the one on Tennant.
Tennant, because it's right around the corner.
Tennant is
literally
a bigger store, isn't it?
Yeah.
The one with the gas station?
Yeah, it has a gas station.
Yeah, that's the bigger store. I like that one better.
Oh, and they normally do, like, but every once in a while you're going to get some flowers that are, you know, going to start to brown or whatever.
Yeah,
because
yeah.
It happens, they don't stay forever.
You know what I'm thinking about this paper towel? It's totally off subject. I wonder if you took these paper towels and you got them, put them on white paper, and then spritzed it with more water and left. Hey everybody, I hope you've enjoyed this little impromptu little chat and painting session Sarah and I had, where we were playing with and exploring and comparing a bunch of different brands of watercolor, including the Kuretake set that she just got. I have the smaller one, and she and I actually both bought small ones at the same time, and she fell in love with them right away and ended up selling that set, passing it along to a friend, and ordered the bigger set because she wanted more colors. She's starting to take after me. That might be a bad thing. I don't know. But she was curious about how they stacked up against some of the other paints, and she knew I have a large collection of paint. Big surprise. You guys knew that, right? And she wanted to know if we could do a comparison. So we had a lot of fun with that. I hope it taught you a few things like it did us. And I love all the brands of paint I have in my collection now. I think that my collection of brands and colors is really coming along nicely. And I hope it gave you some ideas if you are on a budget and you want to start playing with watercolors, of what your options are out there to not only get a nice quality watercolor, but get one on a budget. The Kuretake set is very affordable. It is very readily available. And replacement half pans for every single color are out there and available. I'm sure on a number of websites, but definitely on Jackson's Arts out of the UK for sure. And I'll try to put a link to their store in the description below. The Koi set, of course, is also readily available at Hobby Lobby and a number of other craft stores. They do have a tube set of replacement colors, but it only is 18, so it would work for their 18 color set. I have the 24 set, so the 18 tube refill will only refill so many of the colors, so I would still be missing some. So I'm going to have to think twice about that before investing. I actually am going to have to look and see what colors are missing out of that 18 tube set. But I do love my Koi set. So that's it for right now. If you guys have any more questions about watercolors, let me know. Play with what you do have and just do some of these fun abstracts that you saw me doing at the end and Sarah was doing some off camera. I want you to just play with your colors and see what kind of marks you can make with them and what they do when you add water to them. And you know, while they're wet, you could think about pouring some salt on there and letting it dry and then see what happens. And just play with the paint. Don't worry about trying to make a picture. Just play with the paint and see what you can get it to do and what different colors look like when they blend together and that sort of thing. You will find copyright notices and appropriate disclaimers in the description below of all of my videos from now on, along with all of my contact information. So if you are a person, product, or company that wants to have me do a review on your product, maybe you want to send me something, all my contact information is in the description below, so feel free. Please like, share, and subscribe. Don't forget to have a great day or weekend. I think it's Tuesday? I think it's Tuesday. Have a great week. Don't forget to go out and do something nice for yourself because you deserve it, and I will see you later.